Hello friends, I am CA Divya Bansal, and in today's webinar we will be discussing the entire concept of input tax credit. Now this is very important concept in GST. If you claim wrong amount of input tax credit, that is if you claim more than what you are eligible to, then you need to reverse the ITC along with the interest also. So it is better, instead of paying the interest amount, to claim the right amount of ITC in the beginning itself. For this, we must understand what is right and what all things are eligible for the input tax credit, so that we do not take the claim of wrong items. Before starting with the concept, if till now you have not subscribed my channel, then please do subscribe my YouTube channel. Along with the subscribe button, we have this bell button. If you click onto this bell button, then you will be regularly updated with all the video uploads done by me on my channel. Further, like my Facebook page, where we upload infographics on GST, that is the images containing the GST concepts. So coming back to the concept of input tax credit, first of all, understand some of the definitions which will be used in the entire presentation. First one is inputs. Inputs are any goods other than the capital goods which you utilize for the purpose of business. That is, you use them in course of or in furtherance of business. Input services are any services which are being used or intended to be utilized for the business purposes or for the furtherance of business. Whereas capital goods are the goods which are capitalized in your books, because from those goods you derive the benefit for more than a year and you show them in your balance sheet generally as fixed assets. And also make sure that you utilize such goods in course of or in furtherance of business. So these are three basic definitions. Next one is the input tax. Input tax in GST means IGST, SGST, CGST and UTGST, which is being charged on the goods or services which you purchase. It also includes the taxes which is being paid by you on the imports. Also, in case you pay the tax under reverse charge mechanism, then also such tax will be considered as input tax. But it excludes the tax paid under the composition levy. As you all know that if you purchase from a composition dealer, you are not eligible to take the ITC of the tax amount paid. So we have studied till now the definition of inputs, input services, capital goods and input tax. The credit of the input tax is called as the input credit. So we are eligible only to take the credit of the input tax. Moving further, the next concept is ITC set-off mechanism. That is how the various taxes will be set off against each other. IGST will be first utilized against itself. That is, if you have output tax liability as IGST, then you can utilize the credit of IGST first against the IGST. Then IGST output liability can be set off by CGST and then by the SGST. Whereas in case of CGST, you can utilize to pay your output CGST liability first by CGST itself, and in case it is still remaining, then by the IGST. In case of SGST, again, you can utilize your IGST amount or the SGST amount. But be cautious that you cannot utilize CGST amount against the SGST or SGST amount against the CGST amount. That means you cannot use CGST and SGST against each other, but rest other cases they are being possible, as you can see on the slide. Next concept is that when you are actually eligible to claim the input tax credit in respect of any purchase which you have done. For this, we have basically four conditions which has been given to us in section number 16 of CGST. First condition is that you must have the relevant document. Such document can be a tax invoice or a debit note or other notes as prescribed in rule number 36, which we will discuss later on. Second condition is that you must have received the goods and the services. That is, if you have not received the goods and the services, then you are not eligible to claim the ITC. So till the time you receive all of them, then only you can book the credit in your credit ledger. Third condition is that tax must be paid on such purchase either by cash or by credit. Fourth is that you must have furnished your returns as per section 39. That means if you are a defaulter in filing your return, then again you cannot book your credit. Next comes rule number 36. In this, first thing is that you must furnish the details of all the purchases in GSTR2. As you all know, GSTR2, it is being deferred as of now, but maybe later on implemented by the council. Second thing which it says is that you are not eligible to claim the ITC in respect of the tax which is being paid by you on account of fraud, willful misstatement and suppression of facts. So if you fall under any of these cases, that means you have to pay the tax along with the penalty and interest, but at the same time you will not be eligible to claim the credit of the tax paid by you. Now the third thing which it says is that the other tax paying document on the basis of which you are eligible to claim the ITC are, first, the invoice which is being issued by you under RCM, that is the payment voucher. For more details on RCM, you can definitely refer to our separate video on the entire RCM concept, that is reverse charge mechanism. Second document is the bill of entry in case of imports. Third is the ISD invoice or the ISD credit note. We will be dealing with the concept of ISD in later part of the video. ISD is Input Service Distributor. Now, if you receive the goods in installments and lots, then what is the treatment of the ITC? As you all know, as per the conditions which are required to be fulfilled for booking the credit, you must have received the goods and services. This was the second condition. So, if you are receiving the goods in lots, then till the time you receive the last lot, then only you can claim the credit of the same. But you can avoid this by having multiple billings. So for each lot, you can have separate billing done in order to take the credit on the spot instead of getting the credit only on the last lot. This is a way out for the same. Next is, if the recipient who purchases from the supplier does not make the payment to the supplier within 180 days from the date of purchase, then in that case, he must reverse the ITC which he has taken in his credit ledger. But if after 180 days he makes the payment of the same to the supplier, then he is definitely eligible to reclaim the ITC so reversed earlier. The same it is being mentioned in rule number 37 also. It says that when you are to reverse the ITC, if you have not made the payment within 180 days, then along with the reversal of ITC, you must pay the interest also at the rate of 18% per annum. But exception to this is, first one, as per Schedule 1 of CGST Act, it says that the supply transaction which will be considered as supply even when done without consideration, for example, related party transactions. So in case of related party transaction, this provision doesn't hold true. That means you can book the credit once you have made the payment only, otherwise you cannot take the credit of the same. Second is the supply under reverse charge mechanism. Again, the time you make the payment of tax to the government, you can simply claim the credit. So there's no role of the supplier and the amount of consideration paid to the supplier in this cases. That is, these are the exceptions for the same. Now say suppose you have any of the capital goods, say worth rupees 1 lakh and the tax amount on it is say 18,000. So the total value is 1,18,000. You have two ways to show the same in the balance sheet or the books, you can say. Either you can show the value of the capital asset as 1 lakh rupees and claim the credit of 18,000 rupees on the spot, or else you can simply show the value as 1,18,000 and claim the depreciation on the same. So subsection 3 of section 16 says that if you are charging the depreciation on cost plus GST amount, then the ITC of GST amount will not be applicable to you, will not be available to you. Whereas when the depreciation is charged only on the cost price and not on the tax amount, then you can take the ITC of the tax amount. Next concept is the time limit for taking the input tax credit. Now, from 1st July 2017, GST was implemented. The financial year in this case will be April 2017 till March 2018. Say suppose I have purchased one of the goods in October 2017 and for any reason I forgot to book the credit of the same in my return. Now the maximum time limit by which I can book the credit is that by September 2018, that is the return for the September 2018, which will be GST year 3 for the same, will be going by 20th of October, or the annual return for this particular financial year 17-18, which is 31st December, whichever is earlier. So in any case, the last date in this case will be 20th of October only. So this is the time limit by which I can actually claim the input tax credit if I forgot to book at the time of the purchase. Moving further, now for what all things I'm eligible to take the input tax credit. Now any of the input services or the capital good can be utilized for only two purposes, either for the business purpose or for the non-business purpose. Now, in business purpose also, you can utilize the same in making fully taxable supplies or fully exempt supplies, or in both, that is making both the taxable as well as the exempt supply. In case you are making the wholly taxable supplies, then you can definitely claim the ITC in respect of the same. And in case of partial, that is for both the taxable and the non-taxable component, if you are making, then for the taxable component, you can claim the credit. Now, coming on to the second case, in partly case, the exempt portion which you are making, and in the non-business purpose, in all these three cases, you are not eligible to claim the credit. Now, what about the banking companies or the financial institution? In this, the council has given us two way outs. First of all, either we can segregate our output supplies as taxable and non-taxable, and in the same proportion we can claim our input tax credit, or an easy way out is also given, that is you can simply take only 50% of the total credit which is eligible to you. That means for the remaining 50% you need to reverse the same, and at the same point of time you are eligible to take 100% credit in case of the branch transfers, that is if you are giving any services or any input goods or capital goods to the branches, then for that 100% ITC it is being allowed. You need not take that 50% in case of the branch transfers. Next comes a very, very important concept, that is the block credit. As per section 17 subsection 5, there are certain items whose credit it is not eligible to us. First one in this is motor vehicles and other conveyance. That is, if you purchase any of the motor vehicles or conveyance, you will not be eligible to claim the credit of the same. But you can claim the same in few cases. These are, first one, when you are utilizing the same for further supply of such vehicles. For example, car dealers who are selling the cars to the ultimate customers, they can definitely take the credit of the same when they are purchasing it from the manufacturers. Second one is when you are transporting the goods. Third is the transportation of passengers. And fourth one is when you are utilizing such conveyances, such motor vehicles for imparting the training on driving, flying, navigating such vehicle or the conveyance. Next thing is cosmetic surgery, plastic surgery, food and beverages, medical services, outdoor catering service, and beauty treatments. For all these five services, again, you are not eligible to take the credit unless you yourself are supplying the same kind of taxable supplies, or it is a part of your taxable composite or mix supply. Next is the club membership or the health center membership or the fitness center membership. All these three cases you are not allowed to claim the credit. In case of rent a cab, health insurance, life insurances, again you are not allowed to take the ITC. But in these three cases, exception in this case is when you are supplying the same outward taxable supply. Or second exception is when the same they are being made obligatory by the employer to the employee for any law at present under force. That means if any law mandates you that you need to provide such services to your employees, then in that case ITC shall be eligible, otherwise the same shall not be eligible. Next is the travel benefits which you give to your employees, or when the goods or the services are being received by the non-resident taxable person. In this case, again, one exception is there. That is, if they import the goods into India, for those things, the ITC shall be allowed. For the other things, ITC shall not be allowed. Then if you're consuming those goods for personal purposes, if such goods are being lost, stolen, destroyed, given as free samples, gifts, etc., ITC shall not be allowed to you. Next is very important. The works contract service or the goods or services which are being received by the taxable person for construction of immovable property. In this case, ITC shall not be allowed. But for the works contract services, ITC shall be allowed if you yourself are into the same line of business. That is, you are also giving the works contract services. But in this, immovable property does not mean plant and machinery. That means for all the plant and machineries which you have purchased, you are eligible to claim the ITC of the same. With this, we must have the understanding of rule number 42 and 43 of the CGST rules. For detailed explanation of rule number 42 and 43, refer our separate videos on the same. Coming on to the next section, that is section number 18, which is availability of credit under special circumstances. Now, if you have crossed your threshold limit of 10 lakhs or 20 lakhs as the case may be, then you are liable to take registration and you must take registration within 30 days. In such cases, when are you eligible to take the input tax credit? You can avail the credit immediately preceding the day you are liable to pay tax. In case you have voluntarily applied for the registration, then you can avail the credit from the date of grant of registration. In case you were earlier into composition scheme but now you have switched to the regular scheme, then again you can claim the credit from the day preceding the day when you are liable to pay the tax. And in case you were earlier making only exempt supplies but now you are making the taxable supplies, then you can avail the credit from the day your supply becomes a taxable supply. But you cannot claim the input tax credit in respect of inputs, input services or capital goods whose invoice it is being issued to you prior to 1 year, that is the limit is 1 year in this case, if there is change in constitution on the account of sale, merger, demerger, lease, amalgamation, etc., then definitely you can pass on or carry forward the credit to the transferee. Then is when the registered person who opts for the composition under section 10, or he earlier supplies goods which were taxable but now those goods have been made exempt. In that case, you must pay an amount equivalent to the ITC which is being present in your credit ledger. Now, if the registered person sells the capital goods including the plant and machinery to another person, then he must pay the amount of ITC. What is the amount of ITC that needs to be paid is another question. In this, the amount of ITC that needs to be paid or reversed is higher of first the ITC reduced by the prescribed points as per the details given in rule number 44. Secondly, the GST on the transaction value. So whichever is the higher amount needs to be reversed, but there is an exception. In case of refractory molds, bricks, jigs, dies, fixtures, etc., ITC that needs to be reversed is equivalent to GST on the transaction value itself. Now comes rule number 40. Rule number 40 says that when you opt out of composition scheme or you were earlier supplying the exempt goods but now they have been made taxable, in this case the ITC shall be available to you. And the ITC will be the tax paid on the capital goods minus 5% per quarter of a year or part thereof. And in case of inputs and input services, whatever is the stock lying with you, you can definitely claim the credit of the same. But in case your ITC which you need to avail, it exceeds rupees 2 lakh, then you also need to obtain a CA certificate or a cost accountant certificate in respect to the same. Then comes rule number 41. When the transferor transfers the goods or the services or the capital goods to the transferee, in case of sale, merger, demerger, amalgamation, etc., then he must furnish the details in form GST ITC 02 on the common portal and request for the transfer of the unutilized credit of the same to the transferee. The transferee in return will accept the same on the portal. But along with this, you also require a CA certificate or a cost accountant certificate for the same. Moving on to the next section, that is section 19, inputs sent for job work. Now in this, inputs are the capital goods when they are being sent for the job work to the job worker by the principal. Then input it as being eligible to the principal but subject to some conditions as mentioned in rule number 45. Now, the principal sends the inputs of the capital goods to the job worker. If the job worker returns the same to the principal within the prescribed time period, then it is perfectly fine. You can definitely claim the credit. But if he doesn't send back those goods within the prescribed time, then what will be the consequence? In this case, if the job worker doesn't send back the inputs within 1 year or capital goods within 3 years from the date of receipt, then in that case it will be considered as supply and the GST on the same shall be levied. Principal shall mention the same in his GSTR1. The day he supplied the same to the job worker will be considered as first supply. Second supply will be when job worker supplied the same to the principal, that is when he gave back those goods back to the principal. And the principal must also pay the tax along with the interest as per rule number 45. Now, 1 year or 3 year, it is to be calculated from the date of receipt of input or the capital goods by the job worker in this case. But there are some exceptions. For example, dies, jigs, fixtures, molds, tools, etc. So for all these mentioned exceptions, the time limit is not applicable. Next is rule number 45. Rule 45 says that inputs and capital goods when given to job worker must be accompanied with a challan. The challan should have the date and number of challan, name, address, GST number of the consigner, consignee if required, HSN code of the goods and the other details of the goods which are being supplied to the job worker. And such details must also be given in the quarterly form, that is ITC 04, by 25th of the month of the succeeding quarter. Next is section number 20, that is distribution of input tax credit by an ISD, input service distributor. In this case, first of all, ISD must compulsorily take registration as per section 24. And along with this section, we have a rule number 39 for the ISD only, which says that ITC for a particular month should be distributed in the same month itself and should be mentioned in GST R6. Now, if in case the state or union territory of the ISD is equal to state or UT of the recipient, then in that case, ITC of CGST, SGST or IGST shall be distributed as CGST, SGST or IGST respectively. Whereas, in case the state or union territory of the ISD is not same as that of the recipient, then in that case, the ITC for the CGST, SGST and IGST shall be given only as IGST. And in case the ISD gives the credit in contravention to section 20, then in that case, he needs to reverse the credit along with the interest and the same shall be recovered from the recipients of the credit. So friends, I hope that you found this video useful. So friends, for more useful updates on GST, please subscribe my YouTube channel Tax Without Tears and like my Facebook page. Thank you.